Autocrafters, your source for Cougar, Falcon, Fairlane, Full-Size, Mustang, Maverick, Pinto, Ford Truck. Contact us at www.autocrafters.com.
I got it.
Put it right here.
Okay.
Put it right there. Yeah. Careful, we'll come after you.
Yep.
So, what we need to do, first thing here, is to take the lower control arm off of the spindle, because we're going to talk about spindles today.
Okay.
You're going to learn something about why I like using specific parts for specific cars. These are the perfect spindles for your Ranchero.
All right.
I'm actually a little jealous of your spindles because these are the best spindles to use on a 63.5 to 65 Falcon or Comet or Mustang. Oddly enough, 65.6 Mustang used the same spindle as the Falcon back in the day. So what we need to do now is you need to get this lower control arm off. So what I want you to do is to grab your needle nose pliers and take that cotter pin out. Yes, just like that.
I did it.
Yeah, 18. I don't know if you're going to be able to use that on it. We may need to get an extension.
Doesn't, no.
Yeah, we're going to have to get an extension on it. All right, let me get an extension. We'll go ahead and take that off in just a second.
All right.
All right, I don't necessarily recommend normally doing this, but that goes not that way.
I actually don't. Okay. And then we do
believe it. Me, when I say this is the first time he's ever put a wrench on a car, I'm not lying.
We do this thing here. And
yeah, now.
Wait, is that the wrong way?
Yes.
No.
Go the other way. There you go. It's off. Huzzah. Well, I don't really recommend doing what we just did with the actual nut because we take this off of here and pull it down here. This is what can happen. You'll see the nut's actually angled over and it's actually chucking the nut all the way around the outside perimeter of it. Sometimes you have to do that to get them to come off. What you really want to do is to get a 7/8 inch combination wrench and put it on here to make that work. We got that off now. Now the hard part begins because we're having to take the lower control arm off of the actual spindle. All right, now what we're going to do is we're going to use our pickle fork or a ball joint tool. Basically, it just looks almost like a tuning fork, and you slide it in between the spindle and the lower control arm. And what this is going to do is going to put pressure and pop those apart. And Logan gets to do the wacky motions.
Oh, I might hit your hand.
If you hit my hand, I will slay you.
You watch out. Sounds like, I don't think that's going to go anymore. Okay.
That's going to have to be worked on. I'm just going to put it over there. All right, now what we're going to do is going to put these up on the table and start talking about the difference in the spindles between this and the later spindle, which on an early Mustang or Falcon is not a really good idea. Okay, so correct spindles for a Falcon or 1965-66 Mustang. In 1966, the Falcon moved to the Fairlane chassis.
Mm-hmm.
So the spindles were different. They moved to a different style of spindle. The two numbers or letter forms that you're looking at on the back of the spindle, they're usually right up in here somewhere.
Can't really see it.
Yeah, it's really hard to see on this one, but this is a C5DA, and that means it's a 64, 63 will even work, spindle for Falcon. There's also a C6OA that will work for this as well. But the one other thing that you can do is if you're going to a swap meet and checking these things out, is you can put a tape measure, and I usually get like one of these for Taylor's measures. You can put it up here at the top of this and measure to the bottom of the spindle. That's your distance between the two ball joints. And you're right at 8.5 inches from top to bottom. In that neighborhood will be fine. That's what you want to look for there. And you want to look for about 7.5 between the tie rod end here and your lower ball joint here. Now, why you're looking for this is the reason that Ford changed the tie rod position both in here for drop and also distance in. So the tie rod position moved in and shortened on this, and that affects Ackerman angle.
Okay, which, what is that?
Ackerman angle is actually the distance to the center of the rear axle from both tie rod ends. And Ackerman angle can affect the way the car steers and the way it handles. And they change this with different models of cars. Every different make within the Ford line will have a different Ackerman angle, and the tie rod positions will be different on all of them. If you have a big LTD from this era, it will be different from a Falcon, which will be different from a Fairlane. Mm-hmm. And they changed this stuff a good bit. Now, what happened in 1967 is that all changed completely. On the Fairlane and the Falcon, they were the same vehicle. And in 67, the Mustang was the same spindle as well. So all that became standardized. But it also jacked with the handling just a little bit on some of the other cars. Like the Mustang wasn't necessarily as long as the Fairlane. So they just used the Fairlane Ackerman angle on the Mustang. So it'll affect your steering a little bit. Tie rod position is affected as well. This is your tie rod. It's out here on the end. This ties to the drag link. We'll get into that in just a second.
Okay.
But when you're looking for spindles on a 64 Falcon or a 65 Falcon or a 65.6 Mustang, you're looking for a C5DA or you're looking for a C6OA spindle. Those prefixes will usually get you the right spindle for your car, but make sure that your distances are what I just gave you. Because what happens with these things is they tend to bump steer if you use the later spindles, like from the 67 on up Mustang.
Yeah.
They will tend to bump steer.
What bump steer? What's that?
Bump steer is actually when you're going down the road in a car, since you're not driving yet, let's just pretend for you.
I need to have my permit.
Yeah, well, you got your permit, but you know. Anyway, when you're driving a car, as you get older and get more experienced, so going down the road and you hit a hole, like a chuck hole in the road or a pothole, and the car will want to take off a little bit and kind of go squirrely with you, and it feels like you're kind of out of control for a second, that's bump steer.
Okay.
And Ford had a problem with these setups, even with these spindles, which they designed for that car. They had a problem with bump steer on the 63 and 64 V8 Falcons. The bigger, heavier engine up front combined with the spindle, and it didn't work well. So in 65-ish, because it was a mid-year thing, they changed the drag link. I'm going to pull this off the table, and we're going to talk about the difference in the drag links.
Okay.
This is heavy! Why am I picking this up, not giving it to you? All right, now, drag links. Ford changed drag links around. And what this is basically underneath the car, on your steering system, your steering box mounts here and here on the, this is 64 Falcon, this is 65 Mustang, this is 65 Falcon. Okay. So your steering box mounts through here, the steering wheel's on the other end of it, mounts in these locations here. And then this drag link here basically moves back and forth, moving the tires. In other words, this is what steers your car. Now, Ford put this drag link in originally in 1963 and a half when they introduced the V8 and the Falcon. Mm-hmm. All well and good, except it really sucked. Because the angles were all wrong on it. The drag link was not as well designed as it could have been. And they also went ahead and they used a short inner on both and a short outer on the tie rod end assembly here. You'll notice that compared to the Mustang here, the tie rod mounting positions are basically going out to the same spot, but your center position in here is different. It's a lot further out on the drag length on both ends than it is on the Mustang.
Yeah.
This created a bump steer issue because of the short tie rod length in here. It's not long. And you want a little more tie rod because these tie rods on the Falcon side tend to sit down a little bit. And on a car, you want to have the tie rod ends basically almost flat. Anything outside of that range of flatness when you're just driving straight down the road is going to cause you some problems for bump steer. So basically, that's what happened. Ford decided to change it. And you would think, well, just go ahead and bolt a Mustang one in a Falcon.
No, it doesn't work.
In 65, or actually maybe late 64, Ford moved over to a different tie rod in, or drag link setup that was like this. Now you've got here, it uses a stock Mustang style idler arm assembly that goes in here. And you also have these are your mounting points for your inner tie rod ends. It uses this same tie rod assembly, but Ford went to the trouble of changing the design a little bit. on your Mustang, center to center roughly, center to center on your tie rod ends is 18 5/8. On a 65 Falcon, it's about spot on, maybe it's like 18 1/8. So Ford actually mucked about with it to make sure that these tie rod ends didn't cause as many problems. If you're gonna do a conversion on a car like we're doing on yours, you really want a 65 V8 drag link in the car with these tie rod ends, because that's gonna make the car handle a ton better. And since I don't want you to die in a fiery wreck, we're gonna be putting one of these drag links in the car. This is actually your drag link.
Cool.
So it's gonna be going in your car. I really wish I didn't have to give it up.
Oh.
Because it was gonna go in my 64 hardtop, but his safety, more important to me right now. So that's what we got for that. And I'm gonna pull the front spindle back up in here. And we're gonna look at some of the things that we're gonna need to make sure of when you're putting a set of those spindles on a car, because they are ancient now. 1964 to now, what that's?
A long time.
Let's just say 55 years. It's old, possibly worn out.
More than that, that was longer than that.
Well, 64.
2019 now.
Yeah, but see, that's 1964 and I'm 63. See, I go by how old I am and I'm 55. So they're actually 54. I'm no mathematician, folks. Don't bug me about math. I've got a kid that's really good at math here in the house. I ask him all the math questions. So anyway, I'm gonna pull all this stuff off the table and we're gonna go over the spindles.
All right.
All right, I'm gonna show him how to take a spindle apart. Basically, I'm gonna take the drum off of here so we can check the actual spindle for condition. So go ahead and get that cotter pin out of there.
Okay. First things first.
Bam. Now, you need to take that off.
What is?
It's a cap. What that is a retainer so that the nut underneath there doesn't walk around.
Nothing's. Oh, there we go.
Yeah, you gotta pull it up. Now, see, you have a large format nut there, so we're gonna have to go get some. I'm just gonna go get a pair of pliers for it.
And some paper towels.
No, I'm not gonna get those. Yeah. You're way far away from
paper towels.
Normally, I don't condone the use of these kind of wrenches on this stuff. And when we put it all back together, I probably won't use this. But for taking it apart for our purposes today, that'll be just fine. That one's actually not too bad. Go ahead and pop it off there.
Actually, it's just...
You should be able to just hand spin it now.
It's so nasty.
And you're putting them on the floor. You're getting grease on the floor.
Well,
put them in the tray over here.
There's grease on my hands.
It's going to be worse. It's going to get much worse.
Oh, I hate this feeling. I'm glad I clipped my fingernails before I did this.
You better get used to that feeling, dude. It's the accomplishment of a job well
done. Oh, sorry.
More grease on my floor. Put it right there. Great day. We're going to have to
spend
hours. You look great. Your hands look nice.
Thank you.
All right, now, I'm about to grab a big hammer, so I don't think you want to do that. All right, now, you see that there's the washer, and there's a bearing down inside of here that's going to need to come out, too. And that's your outer bearing.
Oh.
You really can't check anything in here until you get this drum to come off, and it probably is going to fight us. I normally don't do this, but I think we're going to want to replace the studs on this thing, too. Feels like the... There's water down in there, too.
Disgusting.
It feels like the drum is probably captive on here. Like it's, you know, seized to the shoe. So we're going to probably have to flip it over. And when I do that, I can imagine that we're going to get barfing out of this from the grease on the inside there.
A towel. That.
No, that's fine. You can't use those. Your hands will be dirty.
I know, but like putting on the ground, so like, because you were all worried about the oil and stuff.
Look at my hands.
Look at him now.
Start this.
I'm sorry.
I'm gonna go get a box to put this in while we're doing this, and we're gonna probably have to try to take it loose from the backside.
Cool.
Okay.
Bye.
All right. There was water inside of the drum from it sitting outside. That's more our fault than it is anything else. Jay brought us what looks to me so far like a pretty decent set of spindles here. But what I'm gonna try to do is to just get the drum to pop off this side, which it's not really wanting to. It looks like the drum is probably...
It's coming up.
Yep. I'm also putting a hole in the floor of the pan. What I'm doing is I'm just walking it around here, trying to get it to release. Now, you can try going in and using a screwdriver to loosen the star wheel that's up inside of here, but I find a lot of times those are stove up and you can't get them to move when a brake drum's been sitting around this long like this one has. So, sometimes this is the best way to do it. All right, I'm gonna put a pry bar in here. I got one of the camera guys to grab me one to keep it from walking in the other direction too much. And Logan's gonna pry down on that and I'm gonna push the knock it loose on this side.
Yeah.
Huzzah! Yay!
Nice.
Now.
Is that good? Or is that bad?
You stole these. I have not felt one that was that nice in a long time. It's a good thing we got them in out of the weather when we did.
So it's good.
Yes. We're going to put these up on the table here real quick so I can go over what I like about the way these feel. But man alive, these are some nice spindles. I think I'll give you the other ones.
No.
Did I say that out loud?
No.
All right, we're going to put them up on the table. Quit feeling them and start talking about them. I've looked at tons of these spindles, and after I clean this off, it's got a little bit of race wear on it.
Yeah.
You can see where it looks like the actual bearing set that sits on here. And usually the bottom side of these is where you see the most wear. And there is some wear there, but it's low mile wear. I mean, this thing has not seen a ton of miles. There's a little bit of damage. You can see where it's kind of taken some of the lighter finish off and burnished it to a darker color.
Yeah, I see it.
If the other one looks this good, that's probably the nicest set of 65.6 Mustang / 63.5, 64, 5 Falcon spindles I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm. The first ones I've seen.
Well, yeah, so you would know. You think this is what they all look like. Trust me, this is not how they all look. I mean, I'm telling you what, man, Jay really did you a solid on these. And thanks, Jay McDaniels. Yeah, he's one of our longtime viewers. Been a fan of the show for years. Been down here a couple of times. Actually drove down and delivered these to Logan and said, pass it on, man. I want you to give the, you know, I'm giving you these so that you can get into the hobby and enjoy yourself. And Logan really has. He's kind of tied into it pretty neat because he's been out looking at Rancheros and other cars. Yeah. And he's kind of, I guess, developing a love for the automobile as much as you have for shoes.
I don't know. Shoes are pretty up there.
He's a shoe guy.
I like shoes.
I don't care. If they're on my feet, they're walking me, and I don't have a problem. It's okay. Well, you know, that's our Manic Mechanic for this week. I wanted to kind of break these down and take a look at them and thought, what better than to be able to get Logan involved, have him do some of the work that he's going to be doing a lot more of in coming episodes on the show. And we'll be coming back with some more stuff next week. But between here and there, you guys have a great week. We'll see you later. You're a weird child.
Yep.